Coffee can be unhealthy, but addiction to the coffee gang is just what the doctor ordered.
We have in Mike Williams' song Lullaby here on Hot 93.3, the Coffee Gang in the morning, 8:05 a.m. Thank God it's Friday. We always say that because, yes, looking forward to a fun weekend. Missy and Sessa here. We're excited right now. We're in the 8 o'clock hour.
We've got a very, very special guest in the house. Yeah, he's going to have to restrain himself.
Special guest.
He's been standing fanning over you for a minute.
Really?
What? Well, we have the very, very, very special guest. Sensei, shall I let you do the honors?
No, you can do it.
I can do the honors? You sure?
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome.
Okay.
To Hot FM 93.3, he is a nation builder. He's a speaker that, you know, gets you going, whether you are down and out. He is a presidential aspirant. Heard him speak like a couple of years back at New Heritage back in Shomolu. Fela Guru, please welcome Mr. Fela Durotoye to the show.
Great to be here. Thank God it's Friday, but really, thank God it's every day.
Yeah.
You know, and that's where we have to be. Yeah. You know, thank God it's every day. Thank God it's Friday. Thank God it's been everything.
You see, that thank God is every day thing, that's how I live also.
Ooh.
Yeah. Because when you go through ish, you just know that you have thank God for every single thing.
Do you mind
day.
Your language, please?
That's why I said
we're in front of, we have company.
I'm sure.
Mind your language.
I'm sure he doesn't
there
mind.
There will be no issues in things, okay? Okay, please, thank
but
you.
But check this out. Are you a morning person? Like, do you wake up in the morning and be like this? Or do you have to get yourself tuned into this state, this mind state, every time you wake up in the morning?
No, I think I just be. This is me.
Okay.
And the only time when I'm not like this is when I'm about to shut down. So I think I'm just like this is me every time. Pretty much.
There hasn't been a time where you just wake up and you're just like,
No, of course you have days, right? You have days, but those are not your days. Like the days like so for instance, I'm supposed to be taking a 2-day break off the campaign trail.
Yeah.
Right. So this is me tired, right?
Okay. Yeah, you're good tired.
I'm good tired.
You're a very good
tired. No, let me tell you where the thing is, right?
Okay.
When you do what you really love, when you're doing it, it releases energy to you.
That's so true.
Oh, yeah.
So it doesn't take energy away from you.
Oh, my goodness.
No. But you guys know what happens.
You guys know what happens, right? We completely understand that.
Okay. So when you're in the studio,
yep.
You know how
no matter how tired you get.
Now, the only thing is that I don't have a studio, right? My life is a studio.
Wow, nice.
You understand what I'm saying? So when I'm in my space, when I'm talking on the phone, when I'm doing what I do, whatever I do, when I'm, you know, whatever it is, it's releasing energy to me. So I feed off the energy of my assignment. And that's what I'm doing. That's why I wish everybody will find out what it is that they're naturally good at. And then just do it. You know that thing they say, tell people about, yeah, everybody, you get out of your comfort zone.
Yeah.
Forget that nonsense. You're supposed to be in your comfort zone.
Wow.
You know, that's where you're supposed to be. That's where your genius flows. That's where energy comes to you. Who tells, have you ever seen a bird tired of flying? Ever seen a fish drown? Have you ever seen a fish drown from swimming for too long?
He's getting to that moment.
No. You know, find what it is that you feel that this is naturally you. This is what you do. This is what you love. In other words, for me, I always say it this way, right? Don't do what you like to do. Do what you can't afford not to do. No, do something that if you are not doing it, the pain of not doing it will be more than the pain of doing it.
Oh.
That's what you're supposed to
do. Wow.
That's what you're supposed to
do. Oh, my goodness.
I'm inhaling and exhaling.
You see, the reason why I'm making these comments where I'm like, oh, wow, oh, my goodness, is because this week I've been praying, basically, trying, because I like to do multiple streams of income, basically, and I've been trying to figure out what is it that I should concentrate on. So when you're saying these things, it's like an epiphany, and it's just like, God has answered my prayers, and it's given me clarity to basically just hone in on.
And I'm grateful for that. You know, because, you know, there's this thing that we were talking about, this, you know, something that went a bit quite you know, quite far. I don't know whether to even call it viral or not. This thing that I did.
Yeah, identity challenge. Oh, yeah,
can I just say, I'm going to say this because I was saying this to Sensei yesterday. I said that I absolutely loved that you did that because I did not know that that side of you existed.
The cool
because
side.
Because what I've seen, right, when, you know, I see your picture, I see, oh, he's a very distinguished gentleman and he's going to talk the
not
English.
Not distinguished, say it, you know, a bit stuck up, you know.
I didn't say that. I didn't say it.
It's okay.
Hey,
you know, because
I'm not saying stuck up. I'm saying you are very, you're very distinguished. You look very serious, very sort of like, this is what I'm going to do for you. When you did the identity challenge, I was laughing. I was like, this guy is so cool. Seriously.
See,
and then when I came in and I told Sensei, I was like, did you see it? It was really, really cool. He's like, well, you know, this. And I was
I'm like
yes.
I've seen that side
and
before.
And he says he's seen the side. And I was like, I don't know him. So I don't know that side. And when you
and
did that.
And there are lots of people that
like,
don't know that side. About you.
Thank you.
Exactly.
You
know?
Thank
you.
So how
you did it well. Like really well. Definitely.
You know, but what made you do it? Like what made you get into that point? You know, let me just try the identity challenge.
No, I mean, so my team thought it was a, you know, whole hub. FD, have you heard about this?
Yeah.
You know, when
FD,
you're
FD, that's
FD.
It.
FD, oh.
Yeah. No, sorry, yeah.
Okay.
FD
like that.
No.
That's what we're calling him
that's
now.
What,
that's what,
you know,
it.
I remember.
Yeah, everybody calls
FD. Yeah, from way FD. Back, FD.
So FD's said, look, in
FD,
the house.
FD. So they always kind of like bring me up to speed on what's happening, what's hot, what's not. You know, especially when I come back from being around. And, this last weekend, I was in Nasarawa State, I was in Abuja, I was in Adamawa, you know, so just generally just doing the north, you know, everybody has seen, he hasn't been to the north. And it's just amazing how the kind of love, and I think that one other thing I need to drop right here about this is that, you know, we're all the same, we're kind of like all one the same. What is so different about us is the way we see each other, not the way we are.
True.
Yeah.
So when they say, oh, the north, you know, how are you going to, people say things like, how are you going to get to the north? Like, okay, sorry, which one? No, I mean the north, how are you even going to reach them? By air.
Yeah.
I mean, I will go by air and by road. No, that's not what I mean. How are you going to,
how are you going to connect with
people?
Them?
And the point is this, them, they, you kind of like think that there is a them north, and when you get there, I mean, I've always gone to the north. Well, that's the first thing. It's not like I see maybe I'm discovering the north now.
Yeah,
my work has always taken, whether it's business work, I mean, as a business consultant, I most times have to go all around the country for my clients. So it's not like I see maybe there's a, I've always known that everyone in this, in no matter which part of Nigeria it is, they want the same thing, right? They want power. They want to wake up in the morning and feel great about themselves. They want to thank God it's every day. They want to have a good life. They want to, you know, so that's the thing they want. We'll come back to all of that.
Okay, we will come back to that.
But then the question was, how did we do the identity challenge?
Yeah.
It was just because my team said, look, hey, this is a nice thing to do. And they showed me a couple and they said, look, would you like to give it a try? I said, of course. And I was, you know, like I said, I had just come back. I was like unwinding and I just went into the garden. And Tara was there. You guys didn't see Tara.
I told you.
But Tara was, she wasn't the one, she wasn't the hype man, right? I won't tell you who that happened. Everyone knows who my hype man was. But Tara was there, you know, just, I mean, we were just having a good time.
Okay, guys, we have, of course, you know, Fela Durotoye in the studio. You want to ask anything, get on our WhatsApp page. It is 081-800-899-33, HotFM_Lagos on Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat, and also Facebook. We'll be back after this.
Coffee can be unhealthy, but addiction to the coffee gang is just what the doctor ordered.
Hot 93.3, Carlo with the song Faster, 8:21 a.m. Welcome to the Coffee Gang on a Friday. You know, we have Mr. Fela Durotoye in the studio with us. People just sending messages on WhatsApp. Someone says, hello, everyone. Hello to you too. They include your name. Another message says, making my day already. I don't know who just said this. Love. That comfort zone. Do what you love to do and forget about moving out of your comfort zone. I'm facing a whole lot lately because I have denied myself the joy of smile every day. Working for other people ain't just my thing because I got this gift to make everyone work for me. Thank you, Hot FM. Nonso from Sulele. Nonso, that's you that said that, not me. Okay, not me, not messy.
You have the copyright.
Nice. So we're talking off the mic and I was like, okay, why now? Why did you decide right now? or in this moment that you want to come out and be this? Because, like I said, I've known you for like how many years, and I know you are this person that leads, that provokes the mind of people to want to become extraordinary.
Yeah, and
in every way.
So two things. Like, number one, let me say that's what most people see me do on the public front.
Okay? Yeah.
And what earns me money is what I do with organizations. And what I do mostly with organizations is to transform their culture, improve their performance, cut their costs, improve their profitability, grow their market share, things like that. That's all the technical stuff that builds businesses into what it is, that helps them to build structure, build institution, get it to last, you know, get it to grow. That's the kind of stuff I do. All right. But on the public front, you know, I have always believed that there's a difference between a country and a nation.
Yeah.
And that country is essentially just the landmass, the borders, the bridges, the buildings, the all of that stuff. Okay. The nation is about people. Okay. And so a nation is a group of people who may come from different diverse tribes, tongues, and all of that, but they must be united in a sense of one sense of for the common purpose, a sense of vision, and this is what we are here trying to build.
Yeah.
You know? And they must all have like a set of values that drive them together and say, this is what's right, this is what is wrong. Now, cut the long story short, for me, I've always believed that Nigeria is a blessed country in terms of when you look at what we have under our, you know, the soil, our mineral resources beneath the soil, totally. Our natural resources on top of it, and even the human resource. As a country, we are blessed probably more than any other nation in the world, because when you ask which nation do you know that has more in mineral resources, natural resources, or human resources, you literally can't find. And I'm not talking about just asking Nigerians. Ask anybody else around the world, not just in Nigeria. They can't tell you a nation that is more blessed than Nigeria. So we have a blessed country, but we haven't become a great nation. Mm. Because great nations are nations where people love to live, love to work, love to play, love to visit, love to invest, love to do business with. Right? That's what makes a great nation. Now, this is how it goes, right? We found out that to go from country, blessed country, to great nation, all great nations around the world, whether they are blessed with natural resources or not, have one thing in common. Are you ready for this?
Yeah.
It's called good governance.
Okay.
Good governance. So they have good people in governance, good people making decisions for everyone in a way that helps everyone and works for everyone. So you want a nation that works for everyone, you get good people to take those decisions. The challenge has been that it then occurred to me, look, that's exactly where the problem has been. Everybody knows it, that we've not had people who typically want to do for others, you know, but they've sought to do for themselves. They've sought to do for their own children. They've sought to do so. So they'll take their children to the best schools, but then they'll watch our own educational system collapse. We've seen people who would rule over others, but not lift others and lead others. So bottom line was, we knew that we had to fix it. So I asked myself a few questions that I asked you. One day I said, number one, am I happy with the way things are? No. And I'm sure anybody listening to me can answer the same thing. Number two, I asked, do I think Nigeria is blessed enough to be a better country than the way it is now? Yes. Number three, should we allow our children to come and fix this, or should we fix it for our children? I thought it would be a shame for our generation to pass on this kind of nation to our children. Okay, good. So the next one was, when do we start? Well, we start now. So, okay, where do I start? And it became clear to me that if I'm asking everybody else to go and, you know, get involved with good governance and saying, you step into the game, which I've been doing for the last few years. Well, one of my core values is be a role model worthy of emulation. So you know what? You step in and see how other people will step up.
But you're talking about where do you start? Now, most people argue that, hey, you know what? Start little.
Yeah.
You know?
Some people said to me, why don't you start from local government chairman?
Yeah.
Yes. Or even ward councillor. What do you think? The question is, you always choose what to do by what you love. Right?
Okay.
So you start within your whatever vision you're carrying in your heart. Having a local government vision is not anything smaller than having a national vision. Because okay. You don't really choose your vision. Your vision chooses you. I've been pursuing a vision of a new Nigeria for the last, since 2004, actively. You've heard me talk about a new Nigeria. Most people in Nigeria know Fela Durotoye for his passion for Nigeria and his love for Nigeria and the things he's been doing for Nigeria for the last 14 years. So if you're asking me where do you start? I started at the national level talking, helping, reshaping the mind of people 14 years ago. Right? Do you get what I'm saying? But now the people are talking about where do you start politically? Now, this is where we were talking just before we came back online. It's like the question is, well, you know, he does not have political experience.
You know, yeah.
Right?
That's something I was talking to Missy about a couple of months
and
back.
And I keep saying, look, let's be clear. Political experience and leadership experience are two completely different things. Because leadership experience is the ability to be able to identify problems, provide solutions, and make things, spaces, and people better.
Do you think they're separate from one another?
Oh, of course. You know, I mean, I think that the fact that some people have... I mean, so let me put it this way. If you love Nigeria the way it is today, for sure, you should be grateful to political experience. Because political experience has brought us this far. Right? Every time you see a pothole on the road, you should... Twale for political experience. Every time the power goes out and the generator has to come on, you should go and kiss the generator and say, God bless political experience. Because political experience has given everything that we have today. Now, if you don't like what we have today, then clearly it's not political experience that needs to change.
Woo-hoo!
It is something else that needs to change. And I think it's called leadership experience. What does that mean? Find the people who have used little to do much in whatever they do, right? And this is the way it works all over the world. The way it works is, I mean, you get people who have accomplished something in whatever their own area or field is because they've learned how to get to the top of it. And they then find themselves in a way that can serve
influence others.
You know, so let's be clear about this one thing, you know. For me, I think that when you look at the kind of things that I've done, whether it was in 2009, remember we did a project called Mushin Makeover?
Yeah.
Where we mobilized 2,000 people to come out and paint 296 houses in one day, Missy.
Mm-hmm.
One day. And we did
Mushin Makeover. Yeah.
Yes, it's there. It's online. You can Google it, right? And you know, you look at another project we did at one time, Project Raise. You know, students were failing maths. We decided to, I gathered 75 teachers to train 4,122 students. We, you know, found out they didn't have math sets, found out they didn't have four-figure tables, bought them math sets, bought four-figure tables. Those children did much better than they would have done if we were not involved. We went into Oyo State at one time in 2008, you know, trained 48,150 students over a 10-day period. Cut the long story short, the state had always been performing at number 28 on the League of States in NECO in terms of performance. The students that we trained did NECO the next year, came number 4. Wow. Right? And so you ask yourself, look, if
you also did the thing about reading your book around in 2012.
We did, in 2012 we did something called the Global Book Reading Festival. Took a book, 17 Secrets of High Flying Students.
Yeah.
And I gave out 17,000 copies of it to people who couldn't afford it. And cut the long story short, we broke the world record of having the largest number of people reading a book simultaneously. And this is how it trips, eh? We were reading in 9 countries at the same time.
At the same time.
And we were reading in 18 locations in Nigeria at the same time. And there were first ladies of 6 states and 2 wives of deputy governors whose first ladies were not around at that time. So in 8 states around Nigeria, coordinated at the same time, we were reading the same book. And at the same time, in Ghana, in South Africa, in the United States, in the United Kingdom, in Ukraine, there were a few countries around the world were reading at the very same time. So, look, again, it's always about doing something to me that adds value, but doing something that is fun, doing something, and we can do that. The whole Nigeria project can be fun. We can begin to enjoy being Nigerians again.
I'm telling you,
we can build this thing.
When you say it can be fun, being in governance in Nigeria is really not fun. The political thing is not fun because people will say this. People will like, you all you have is private sector experience or private sector knowledge.
Well, so, but that won't be true, right?
Yeah, that won't be true.
Because none of the projects we've talked about.
A lot of governments.
Yes.
But coming at the national level, international level, and you know, you and I know that we have a lot of people that would stifle plans that, you know, anybody that's aspiring to make Nigeria great. Yeah. will stifle those plans and just because of their selfish interest not make you. How do you intend to deal with that?
Yeah, so by raising a number of people who also have the selfish interest of wanting to give a better nation to their own children. See, the challenge is not the people who don't want Nigeria to work. The people who don't want Nigeria to work and are benefiting from it are doing their own work.
And
they're doing it very well.
Yeah.
The guys that are making sure that we don't have power, even when we have power, so that we can buy diesel, are doing their work. That's not my problem. The problem that I have is the people who want Nigeria to work but are not doing anything about it.
Hmm.
That's the one. Those are the guys that are listening to me who typically today may just be left to all these, it can't work, you won't work. Have you tried? No. Do you, like the people who say, you don't have, my our votes will not count. Do you have PVC?
I hate hearing
that. No. Okay, well, for sure, if you do not cast your vote, it for sure will not count,
definitely.
But if you cast it, it may count. You know what? Let me say something, and I put this out as a tweet last week on Instagram. I said, life never guarantees you success. It will never happen. The people who make great things happen in life are the people who focus on the probability, the chance of success. There will be chance of success, of course, and a chance of failure. But those who do nothing focus on the fact that it may not work, the chance of failure. And because of the probability of failure, they would decide not to do anything and get the certainty of failure.
Definitely.
And that's what really failure does. That's the what the sense of. So because you may not win, should you not run? Because you will, your candidate may not win, should you not vote?
Should you not vote?
You know, and now I'm hearing people say, you know what? Guess what? I'm going to waste my vote on Fela Durotoye. I'm saying, please.
What is
okay? Waste it, because I would rather you waste it on me or anybody else. And it doesn't matter whether it's me. Let's be clear. It doesn't matter to me whether it's me or not. What matters is that at least you make that vote. Let me be clear. Your vote is not a gift to any candidate. Your vote is your opinion of the nation you want to live in, the kind of values you want to see in your children, and the pathway that you think we can use to get there. So anybody you are voting for should be someone whose vision of Nigeria resembles the kind of Nigeria you have in your own heart that you want to see.
Oh, interesting.
It must be that the person looks like the kind of person you want your children to be like. Guess what? Because in the end, whoever is your president, the values of that president will soon become the culture of the society.
Yeah.
The third and most important thing is that they must be saying something that makes sense to you about how do we possibly fix this thing. And let's be clear, the president doesn't need to know everything.
Okay.
If he can be humble enough to understand that even though I don't know everything, there are people who know everything about what needs to be known concerning that matter. Bring them together and then listen to them. And that's what great leaders do. Great leaders listen rather than talk. They appreciate the fact that we have two ears and one mouth, which means you should listen more than
talk. Yeah, okay. Missy, we're going to say
what do you think? What are the core values of leadership?
In my own opinion, that I'm living by 10 values, right? 10 simple values that to me would make anyone great. Mm-hmm. Number one, I've chosen to make a positive impact on everyone I meet and everywhere I go. Okay?
Yeah.
Meaning that everyone I meet must be better than the way I met them. Everywhere I go must be better than the way I got there. Number two, be a solution provider and not a part of the problem to be solved. If you're going to be a great leader, you can't complain about problems. Let me put it this way. Complaining is not a leadership skill. Solving a problem is a leadership skill.
Yeah.
Number three, as a real leader, you must have a value to be a role model worthy of emulation. Be an example of everything you want to see in others. Okay, which is part of the things. If I want people to run, okay, go ahead and run yourself.
Okay, we'll do four and number five, four. And then we'll come back and take the remaining
okay,
five.
Okay, fantastic. Number four, be your best in all you do, particularly the things you're naturally good at. It's talking about that comfort zone thing.
Again. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But number five, and then we'll come back and take the remaining. Number five is do the right thing at all times, regardless of who's doing the wrong thing.
Okay.
Oh, I love that.
And those are five of the 10 values that I have been living by, and more importantly, I have been pushing into the psyche of Nigerians. Over 300,000 people have signed up to push those values today in over 313 schools in Nigeria today, that they have signed up to those values. Children recite those values in the morning. Children, they've got teachers that form values clubs and with students, and they choose one of those values and decide this is how we're going to do it, with dance, drama, music, art, and so in over in over 300 schools today, as I speak to you, these 10 values that I've shared, 1 to 5, are being practiced, are being recited, are being demonstrated, and it's just amazing. Now, we've been doing that since 2012. So somebody will come and say to me that you don't have leadership experience, but you're changing the lives of children in schools. You're driving values into the schools.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if I was, National Orientation Agency, DG, do you understand?
Okay.
Leadership is about solving problems, making things better, making places better, making people better. I've been a leader by the grace of God, and I know that there are many leaders. You guys in here, you're leaders. I think what's happened is we've been skewed in our minds, thinking that leadership is always about a position, that leadership is about an appointment, that leadership is... And for the last 14, 15, maybe 20 years, I've been trying to prove to people, you are a leader. You're a leader. Don't wait until you get an appointment to become a leader. Begin to lead now.
Okay, so we're going to come back and take the main five values as regards to core values of living. Also, try and find out the schools that recite that every morning.
Yeah,
I want to know how grassroots, in touch is. And also, with some other very, very interesting things as regards Mr. Fela Durotoye. Remember, HotFM_Lagos on Twitter, WhatsApp 081-800-9933.
Coffee can be unhealthy, but addiction to the coffee gang is just what the doctor ordered.
Missy, Hot 93.3, how you doing?
I am fantastic. Pretty blown away.
Lagos this morning.
I'm speechless. That doesn't happen very often. Does not happen very often. I have an opinion about everything, basically. Mm. And I've just
been speaking your mind.
I think.
Okay. Before we go into that, there's how open-minded are you as a person?
Well, generally, first of all, I think I have an open mind.
Okay.
To most things.
Yeah.
I think my mind, the borders of my mind are guided by my values. So
okay.
Anything that violates my values already goes into impossibility for me.
Okay, so
remember we're talking about those 10 values?
Yeah.
Yeah. Those.
Let's finish the five. Okay,
so the first one we did is make a positive impact on everyone you meet and everywhere you go. Be a solution provider, not a part of the problems you solve. Be a role model worthy of emulation. Be your best in all you do, particularly what you're naturally good at. Do the right thing at all times, regardless of who's doing the wrong thing. Number six, value time and make the best use of it.
Okay.
And number seven, care and show respect to all through your words and your actions.
Yeah.
Number eight, consciously build a great legacy, starting now, today, and every day. Number nine, live a life of integrity and honor. And number 10, make your family, your nation, and your God proud. Now, these are values that we've been sharing since. Listen, we printed these things into cards,
mm-hmm.
right? I wish I had one of those cards. Yes. We call them yellow cards, right? And this beautiful yellow card, simple, small. And we've given out over 400,000 of those cards. And we've never given it to anybody who didn't ask for it. So we don't force it into people's hands, right? We've given out over 400,000 cards. And we have never charged a kobo for one of those cards.
Okay. We've
never said to anybody...
Yeah, pay for it.
Pay for it. Take 10 naira, 15 naira. You know, some people say to us, why don't you use it to raise money? I said, no, you can't charge for values, right? Like, values are just... They're invaluable. Do you understand? How do you sell values to anybody? And so, bottom line is, we've been living by those values. So you ask me, am I open-minded?
Yeah.
If anything is in line with my values, then it passes through to the next level, which is my senses.
Mm-hmm.
Because your values are in the heart, right? Your senses are in your brain or in your mind. When it passes the values test, my heart's test, then I can get to the point where I process it. So the fact is, if you say to me, am I open to...
Oh, let me ask a question.
Okay.
Let me ask a question. Because we're in a society, I believe, that is constantly evolving. Mm-hmm. We're 2018. Mm-hmm. People accept a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
We allow Western influence mm-hmm. A lot into our culture. Mm-hmm. What would you do? I know you have kids.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine a scenario where a daughter or a son of yours comes and tells you at a certain age, like, daddy, I am gay or I'm lesbian. Yeah. How would you react to that?
Well, so first of all, that's what the child has discovered or said about themselves.
Yeah.
The first thing you're going to do is to respect that. Because without respecting, you can't even reach them.
Okay.
And do I have my own values about it? Yes, they're guided by the scriptures. So, but that's my values. What you typically would hope is that you've raised your children up in the same pathway that gives you your values, that should help them to be able to come to the point where they decide what their own values are. But the bottom line is, you cannot affect anybody without respecting them first. And if a child says, this is who I am, if the child said, I am gay, that me, fella, I am gay, I would say to him, I'm not. But if the child says, he or she is gay, I can't say you are not, because that's who you believe you are, that's who you think you are. All right? So we are going to have a conversation and begin to say, tell me why you think you are. Why do you think you are? How do you think you are? Does this go with our value? Well, yes or no. But the point that I'm making here is everyone deserves to be respected. That is my value system.
Okay.
I care and show respect to everyone. Remember?
But it's tough to swallow.
No. It is tough. It is tough for anything that is not you. Okay? That's how it is. Right? It's tough for anything. And that's why we usually... But tough is not bad. And tough is not hard.
But it won't. It doesn't go with your core value system.
It just... Yes. Well, it doesn't go with my core value system. But that doesn't mean I won't respect it. Now, let's be clear about something.
Yeah?
The law is the ultimate respect that we would have. Would I change the law? No, I will not. Why? Because I don't have the power to change the law. Okay? But if the law were to then allow it... Right, if all the senators and to change the law in Nigeria, you remember what happened with not too young to run?
Yeah,
you're going to have 2/3 of the states in Nigeria, right, pass by 2/3 of a majority in the state houses of assembly,
mm-hmm.
right, and then you're going to have that happen at the Senate and at the House of Representatives. If the thing can go through that, well, that's what it is that Nigerians want. If it can pass through that, okay, so. It's not something that I would try, I would converse, I would pursue, because it's not necessarily what it is that is my personal value system. But my value system says I respect, I will care and respect, show respect to everyone through my words and my actions.
Okay, Missy, you want
to... Okay, because what you just said now, basically, there's a hypothetical situation, right? So this child comes to you and says this to you, basically. You wouldn't canvass for it personally, but then you feel that the law that is in law of the land right now says if anybody is discovered to be gay, gets 14 years in prison. So do you agree with that?
Do I agree with the law? But that's what the law says. I'm not going to fight it.
Would you actively... And you said you wouldn't fight against it.
No, I will not actively fight against it. That is what I will not do. Okay? But if the people... Like, you know, the government did not pursue Not Too Young to Run.
Yeah.
The people who believed in it pursued it
mm-hmm.
till they got it. Anybody else can pursue that and get it? Fantastic. But I will not be the one conversing with it. I respect everyone, regardless of your gender, or, you know, sexual orientation, or what your belief system is, or your religion. I've never loved anyone less because they were not a Christian. I've never treated anyone less because they were a child, or because they were whatever. Who you are, let me put it this way: in my opinion, and this is me being real with you, not just because I'm on air. Everybody who knows me knows I've said this thing before. I believe that God is in everyone. I believe that everyone carries God in them. And I believe that there is no smaller version of God. So whether you're a child or an adult, it doesn't matter. God is in you. And for me, I honor the God in you. That's where the foundation of my honor for every individual is. So bottom line that I'm making here is this. I respect everyone. And to respect means to bestow honor on others.
Okay.
I care for everyone. To care means to be concerned about the very best well-being of every single person. All okay. right? So my point is this. As a person and as a president, I will care for every Nigerian. I will respect every Nigerian, regardless of tribe, tongue, religion,
yeah, because
or
you're taking the crazy hypothetical question I just asked into the next phase, mm-hmm. because Nigeria is as diverse
yeah.
as you can ever imagine.
Not to me though.
But people have different core beliefs.
I'm gonna interrupt right here.
Yeah.
Like there was a man. Is it? I can't remember his name. The was a senator who married a 13-year-old girl, right? And basically that law was, it was, the bill was going to be passed in, but it wasn't passed into law. For example, that in itself, personally, it goes against my core values. Does it go against your core values?
Absolutely.
Okay, so would you campaign on that? Even though people have tried to pass it, and it's a possibility again that it won't get passed, would you campaign actively for that, basically?
Yes, I would.
Okay, so
because my values, in, let me put it this way, because I believe it violates a child.
Mm-hmm.
I believe, and we have statistics, we have medical statistics that have shown that children that are underage children who are, you know, in a way prematurely engaged in sexual activity and having children, typically have different kinds of you know, what you would call, what's that word again? Something that is unnecessary in disease, you know, like a disease that you didn't have to get.
Mm-hmm.
What's that word? You know it now.
I'm trying.
You know it. They use it a lot of times.
Yeah.
Premature.
No, not premature. No. Okay. Anyway, you know, but they get these diseases, right? I think one of it starts with F. So now they're saying he doesn't even know the name of it. Because I don't think it's fistula.
He's human.
But the bottom line. Oh,
yeah,
thank
they do
you.
Get.
He's human.
Thank you.
Like everybody else.
But the bottom line is, again, that I think, in just protecting the rights of children, I think every girl has the right to be able to grow up and be everything that she can be and take a decision on who she can marry.
That brings us to the subject of feminism.
We'll get there, Missy, please. We'll get to feminism.
Because okay. There was a picture you took.
Yes. Yeah, that
there
caused,
were no female aspirants in that picture. No. Why?
Wait. First of all.
Why?
No. There was a female aspirant. It depends on which one.
Okay, I'll pull the picture up.
Is it three people or four? Or
there are a whole like bunch a of you. There are like 10 of you.
There was one female aspirant in there.
Okay.
Right? Most people may not know her, but there was a female aspirant there. Okay. And there was a female aspirant that was in the meeting that had left just before that picture was taken.
Okay.
All right? And then, listen, if a group of people, if people were invited to a meeting,
mm-hmm.
and I was just invited to the meeting, I wasn't the one that convened the meeting. If people were invited to a meeting and you go for the meeting and maybe the ladies don't show up. Now, let's be clear. They did, at least two ladies showed up.
Yeah.
One of them was in the picture. The other one, can you put it up? I'll show you.
Yeah.
The other one was not. So it depends on, there were two pictures. So help me find the one that I'm talking about.
Okay.
So it depends on which one it is. I was invited to a meeting. Other people were invited. I showed up. Some people didn't. You can't say, well, sorry, there's no lady here. I'm not going to take a picture.
Okay. So we'll go back to the feminism thing. You know, the reason I asked that question is this. Guys, if you still want to ask the questions, @HotFM_Lagos on Twitter. WhatsApp 081-800-899-33. Because there'll be, sometimes I feel like when you get into politics, there'll be a conflict between your religious beliefs mm-hmm. and then your personal beliefs. And then what should be from a leadership standpoint, what is good for the nation or for the people that you are supposed to be leading?
Okay, so where things are done properly within your own internal system,
yeah,
first of all, your personal beliefs can be informed by your religious beliefs, but your personal beliefs are also going to be informed by very many other things.
Yeah,
traditional beliefs, your experiences in your home, blah 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 blah, you know, that kind of thing. So who you are not you are a makeup of many influences, right? Including what's going on. So your belief system is your value system.
Yeah.
It can be informed by your religious beliefs. So your religious beliefs may be in alignment with your values or may not be in alignment with your values.
How would that affect, let's say...
I think in the end, there are decisions that you can take that are decisions meant for your office, and there are decisions that are meant to be taken by the institutions. Right, and where the institutions take those decisions, right? Sorry, I was just quickly showing.
Yeah,
that's not the one. Okay, that's good. Not the one. I'll
okay,
pull
so
up the picture.
So just to let you know that there was a woman in there. Okay, but bottom line is that, you know, we are all a makeup of what we believe, and this is why it's important that you look at the belief system of the person that you want to appoint into any office, whether the person is going for elective or legislative office, it doesn't matter. You better check their beliefs, because your beliefs or your values affect your decisions, and your decisions will affect everything else, the outcomes, the results, and everything else that happens.
Okay.
So you better make sure that you say to yourself, I want to make sure that the person that I'm going to vote for values life. at least of a human being more than. Okay, leave that story.
Okay, you know what? We're going to come back after this, and then we need to round off. It's been fantastic, but we're still going to be coming back, guys. Keep it locked, Hot 93.3. Questions coming in. I'll be taking them on WhatsApp, 081-800-899-33.
Coffee can be unhealthy, but addiction to the coffee gang is just what the doctor ordered.
We're still here, the Coffee Gang 906. We're going to be rounding off with Mr. Fela Durotoye. It is Visual Radio Hot FM.ng. Click on Lagos Puzzle. Now, he has no idea what I'm about to ask him to do.
Do you like to dance? No. Are we going to get into the dance?
Do you like to dance?
I need to ask a question.
No.
You know why?
Why?
Because I'm going for dance classes today. And I'm not joking. Koffee actually promised me. She said, okay, you know what? I've seen you trying to dance on. So, you know what? Come. So,
okay.
When I leave this place, I'm actually going to Koffee's. So, if you want to watch me dance.
Come on!
No, do this. No, for real. If you want to watch me dance, just stream live in the next one hour.
We're live.
No.
You have to give us something.
Yeah, I'm going to disgrace Koffee. Because
Koffee, if you are listening or watching, Koffee, this is
just watch, take, wait for
take
me
tips
tomorrow.
As like, regards what you should tweak when it comes to his dancing. Okay,
just so, wait for me now. Just
I'm very persistent.
In 2 hours,
so we're gonna do this.
In 2 hours, I will be a better long. Version of the man I am this time.
See, bros, I don't bring her down
okay,
to local level. I go teach you Shapali, Missy Shapali, and the song that we have to use. Come over. Carry camera. Carry camera, Shapali. You see this song we want to use? This is the Shaku Shaku thing. Let's go, baby. Let's go. So, Missy, you have it.
I go bless you with money, oh my girl. And let you marry, bless you with body, oh baby. Star boy, go bless you with money, oh my girl. Yeah. Sucker, baby. Sucker. Oh, yeah, get from lock. Yo, get from baby. Yeah. Suck. Oh, when I come through, they know we survive, so they turn up all eyes on me now. So many things to pitch.
Couple of questions came in, and let's just see how many we can take here. This one here says, please do say this quote. Oh, somebody's asking to say this quote. Sometimes one must follow one's conscience, core values, not one's duties. Gary from BGC, I think he's been listening to you and he's just been thinking. He also says, so you mean to say you wouldn't pursue it just because your child is involved? I think he's talking about the conversation again, we had earlier.
Again, I think that, like I said, it's your values are the things that will determine what it is that you're trying to get and what it is you guard against. That's just what I have to say.
Okay,
there's another comment here saying, wish our political leaders would sit down and listen to these values, perhaps even recite it before they start any meeting sections. It will help change most of their evil plans and self-centeredness. Believe me, our country will change for the best.
Okay, and two things that I can quickly say now. If you like those 10 values and you wish that they could become the kind of values that we would have as Nigerians, First thing, please send an email to mypersonalcreed@gmail.com.
Okay.
You don't even have to type anything into the email. Just send an email to mypersonalcreed, one word, mypersonalcreed@gmail.com. It would actually come back to you as an auto response with an electronic version of the yellow card that I was talking to you guys about. And you can use it, you can put it out there. And what I always say to people is, for 10 days, just say it, share it, show it. And what that means is say it every day, morning and evening, recite it. By day 7, you won't even need the card to be able to recite those 10 values. But number 2, share it. Share it with your friends, share it on Instagram, share it on posts, whatever your social media handle is. But most importantly, share it with the people you care about the most.
Okay.
And then number 3, show it. You know, go out and then try to do something because of those values. So take, for those 10 days, decide you have one value and, you know,
mypersonalcreed@gmail.com.
I have one question, please.
Okay.
Please.
And we have to talk about PVCO.
point.
Oh, no, that one.
Okay, so one of the things that, because we constantly sit in here with everybody and we're talking politics and we're talking this, and Sensei has always been a very huge advocate of you, basically. My question, and one of the things that I've always said is this, right? And he's like, you're new, so you can do it and all that stuff, right? My question is this. This system is entrenched in basically a system. Mm-hmm. They have a way of doing things. Mm-hmm. And you have mentioned that, you know, if you were to get in, basically, you would then pick people who are at the top of their careers and have been able
to... And who share the same values.
Exactly. And who share the same values as you. But how do you, like... change the core? How do you, for example, deal with what they call the cabal? How do you deal with people who are saying, no, you have to negotiate with us, and they pretty much like hold you at ransom?
Okay, so the first thing is that the cabals only put a handcuff on your hand when you collect their money.
Right.
Right. So the only, the first way to deal with a cabal is not to collect their money.
But can I just say this? It's not their money. It's Nigeria's money.
It's Nigeria's money.
It's not their money.
Even then, though, it depends on who you're collecting it from.
Yeah.
Okay. So the point that I'm making is you're better off, and we have it. It's evident. We even put out our expenses for the first time in Nigeria's political history. You know, that an aspirant will put out his expenses and say, this was where I went, this was how much I spent. That level of transparency, we did that. But this is the big idea that I'm calling. When Nigerians pay through their 1,000 naira, the 500 naira, 200 naira, when they pay for this process, they will own the process. You only owe the cabal when you collect money from the cabal. All right? So I'm trying to build the largest cabal, right, in Nigeria's history. Like 180 million people who I'm asking own this. And you can own it for as little as 1 naira. It is yours. At least you know you put something into it, not just took something out of it. And the second thing is that whenever it is that you, and I think that this whole system thing is quite overrated. And I will tell you why. I'm not saying that it's not real, but I'll tell you why. We are here right now in Itiosa local government. And this local government had a local government election last year. And there are 4.5 million people who live and reside in this local government. And not to talk about the people who work in this local government, but who live and reside here. And you would expect that, you know, if these systems, these godfather systems, these established part systems, were so strong, they should be able to make sure that this is the third richest local government in Nigeria, the fastest growing local government in Nigeria. Bottom line is, do you know how many people came out to vote for the local government chairman the last time? It was out of 4.5 million people, of which over 2.5 million people are above the age of 18.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Total, 11,769. Wow. That's how much the system was able to mobilize. The People's Democratic Party was able to mobilize 1,141 people.
Mm-hmm.
The 10,600 and something was what APC, with all its might in Lagos, was able to mobilize people to vote in. You and I can do better than that, sir, in this Lagos. And this is what I'm trying to say. Look, the point I'm making here is that people are tired. They are really tired of where Nigeria is today. And they know that these same people have brought us this far. They are tired. Look, people talk about how bad, it's elections or no, it's elections, 300,000 people, all the votes that were counted, 300,000. Do you know how many people registered to vote in Ekiti? 900,000. So 600,000 people, literally, of almost 500,000 people, did not collect money, but they did not vote. So the real challenge we're dealing with, guys, is not the people who collect money to vote. If you're listening to me, the real challenge we're dealing with is those who don't collect money but just don't vote.
Mm-hmm.
We are the ones. Give you one very quick statistics, and I know we are almost right. 2015, 96 million people were above the age of 18. This one I need you to do. Be careful for the way I'm going to throw these numbers. It's going to blow your mind, right? 96 million people were above the age of 18.
Yeah.
68 million voters' cards were issued. Some of them permanent, some of them temporary. 28 million votes were counted, including rigged votes. So let's even assume that every rigged vote is a bona fide vote. Still, 40 million people that got their voters' cards did not vote. Add that to the 28 million, you don't forget 68 million to 96 million, another 28 million that also did not even bother to get their voters' cards.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at the people, 28 million that didn't get their voters' card, plus 40 million that got their voters' card didn't vote, that's 68 million. So how many people did I say got registered? 68 million people. Remember.
Yeah.
Not doesn't mean that 68 million voters' cards were issued and none of them voted. But the point I'm making is there were 68 million people that did not vote. That means the 2015 elections were not decided by the people who voted. They were decided by the people who did not vote. So this idea about thinking that, oh, the system is so rigged, so corrupt, that the people are collecting money. You that you will not collect money. What are you doing? Are you there? Are you not? If you're not there, the question is, what's going to happen will happen. Can you talk to the people that you know? Then let's talk about that. And so for me, I think the first most important thing as we wrap up in 1 minute is we need to all decide to go and get our PVC. Our PVC is not just the permanent voter's card. It is the power to vote your choice. And in 2019, the choice is not going to be between APC or PDP or any of those things. The choice is going to be between the old Nigeria that we have today and the new Nigeria that we want. End of story. You choose and you decide what it is. Your children will ask you about this election, I promise you. And if you tell your children any nonsense about, oh, they did not, there is no day that your children will respect. Because your children are going to say, you were the largest day that this country had. And the question was, what did you do? And I'm asking people, get up and get involved. That is the most important thing. Go and get it. Now, we are going to do everything we can to make sure that that INEC does extend voters' cards registration till December. Whatever has to happen, it will happen. But we must make sure that you can't stop people from you can't disenfranchise people from getting their voters' card. Everybody that wants to vote in Nigeria must be allowed to vote. Okay. And that is very important. So for me, please go out and get your vote. Whether your vote counts or not is not the issue. If you don't cast your vote, it will not count. And please let us be sure. INEC cannot count votes that were not cast, and INEC cannot count tweets.
Yeah.
INEC can also not count prayer points.
Yeah.
So get up and get off. And I'm not asking you to get off the phone. Just the same way I'm not asking you to stop praying. But I'm saying beyond the prayers, beyond the tweeting, go and take action. Get your voter's card, even if you don't know who you vote for. That is a conversation after you have gotten your voter's card.
Okay. Thank you so much, Mr. Fela Durotoye, for coming through. Thank you. It's been a fantastic time, and we are out of time as regards the interview. One final question. What football club do you support, local, international? Football club?
Eyimba,
local. That's it, huh? International?
The international is very dangerous. Why? Because I have three sons, and my three sons support two different clubs,
and they are.
I've been trying to. I like.
I know, but seriously, they are one club and one club.
So my sons are Man U and Liverpool, and the guy who's Liverpool is.
No!
So you see now, look at that. That's what I have to enjoy in my home, right?
Okay, so this is where the interview ends. Thank you so much, Sam, for coming through. It's been a pleasure to have you here. Guys, the show continues. Man, you are Liverpool.
Thank you so much.
Coffee can be unhealthy, but addiction to the coffee gang is just what the doctor ordered.